Hey gamers, I'm Matt, and I love vintage games. I love vintage games. I started getting them a long time ago when I got new board games. I said, hey, I wanted to get some old board games. And I absolutely had a great time with it. Eventually, I had to separate my vintage list from my regular board game list because I realized that even though these games here are fantastic, they're not as advanced as some of the newer games on my list, but they are still endearing, and I still love playing them. Love playing them with my nephews, and as the years have gone by, we've had some great times together, and I'm growing up with my niece is getting about that age where she can start playing some of these games, and pretty soon it's going to be me and her playing all these games, and then after that, hopefully my daughters will be old enough and we'll be playing these games. I expect plenty of memories from these vintage games. And that's why I'm always happy to bring my top 100 vintage games to you. Now last year I said I probably wasn't going to do this again because I didn't add, but I think like one or two vintage games to my list. I thought that just wasn't exciting. Well, I actually added quite a few this time. And who knows, I may have a surprise as I move through my top 100 for you as well. But I wanted to talk about today the 20 games. Yes, 20 games. I have 120 vintage games in my collection, which 20 did not make it. Now, what do I consider a vintage game? Everyone has their own opinion on what vintage means. Mine means it has to be out for at least 15 years. Reprints can and do count as vintage in a way. So anything from restoration games is privy to be on this list. But it has to have been in print 15 years ago. I do have some games in my newer collection that seem a lot old, and they won't hit the list till another 2 or 3 years, which is a shame because they're really low. But that's kind of the bar I set years ago, and that's the one I'm sticking to today. Again, your definition may be different, and that's totally fine. So what were the 20 games? The 20 games in order, as I count down it from 120 to 101, that didn't make the list. Well, folks, you know some of them already. Number 120 would be Treasure Trolls. I hate this game. Played this game with my wife again. Now, luckily, you just roll the die, which it looks really nice. The pieces are Treasure Trolls. The die looks like a big ruby. And you're going around getting all these little jewels, this little plastic costume jewelry. It looks fun, right? But if you don't land on the exact spot, you have to move all around the board again to land on that one exact spot to get that one special jewel. The game can take hours. I'm not playing. It can take well over an hour, close to 2 hours, and no game should be that way, as you're constantly aggravatingly trying to get the exact roll to get on that jewel. Thankfully, we played the game where my wife got exact rolls. I was happy for it because I didn't want to play that game. So, looks like a beautiful game, but is an awful, awful game. My 119 is Strawberry Shortcake. I think it's the recipe game. There's a lot of Strawberry Shortcake games, but in this one, basically, you're just rolling the die and just moving around the board over and over again, collecting recipe cards, and avoiding the Purple Pie Man and Crackle. That I know those names embarrasses me. There is nothing to this game. The missus loves this game. I'm sure when my girls get older, they'll love the game, and maybe I'll love the game, but it's basically just roll and move and pick up cards, and that's basically it, and it's not really that good of a game. My number 118 is the Little Mermaid game. Thankfully this year, my little niece does not want to play it anymore. She forgot about it. Yay! It's not a very good game either. You're spinning this, I think you're spinning a wheel and then going to your fish is moving to that area, and if you land on Ariel, you're moving Ariel up the board. The last one to move Ariel up to Eric wins the game. Don't get this game. It's not a good game. My number 117 is a terrible game as well, and it's mine. It is the Superpowers game, Skyscraper Caper or whatever. It looks amazing. The pieces look great. You can be Wonder Woman, Robin, Green Lantern on top of Superman and Batman. You're fighting Penguin, Joker, Brainiac, and Lex Luthor, and the pieces look great. And it's a 3D building, and it looks awesome. They're different building sizes, and the game just really pops. And it's roll and move. It's a game of tag. Villains are going this way. If the villain catches up with you, you fall into a hole. If you catch the villain, you get a point. Totally dumb. I've tried a million times to come up with different ideas to make the game better. I tried even trading this game, and because the guy wanted the game, I was like, well, if you want it, here, let me see what I can trade for it. He went, you know what, I figured I don't want it anymore. Maybe he saw my review. Maybe he watches the channel. I just don't like the game. I wish I did, because like I said, it looks beautiful, but it's not really that good of a game, in my opinion. So Unfortunately, that's why it will always be at the bottom of my list. If someone can come up with a rule set that will make this game pop, it will soar up to my top 100. But for right now, it's going to stay at the bottom. My number 116 is the Power Ranger game. I told you that if this game was called Voltron, it would probably be in my top 100. But because I'm not a Power Ranger fan, it never really made the top 100. I did try to get this to the table. I tried to push it on my wife a couple of times, and she did not want to play it. Now, she is a big Power Ranger fan, and I guess I could have brought it to my nephews one day and we could have played, but at this point we just never played it. So it never got played, so it never got its fair shot to move up the list here. Would it have made it? I don't know. Like I said, I'm just not into Power Rangers that much. It is a cool vintage game, but if I got to play it again, who knows? Who knows? Who knows what it could have been? But for right now, it's going to land here on the list. My number 115 is the Care Bear game. I'm not sure which one it is. I'm probably going to put a picture of the cover up here. But this cover, my wife absolutely loves it. It spins, spinning and moving to the different areas to where you're trying to get the certain icons to lay out your place among the clouds to get to the center of the board. The cool thing is we were missing a piece to this game for years. I finally found it on eBay for like a buck. It was a pawn piece we were missing. So now we have all four Care Bears. We can play with four players now. My wife absolutely loves the game. I am not a fan of this one. When my girls get older, they'll probably like it and we'll probably play it. But to me, it never really was that good of a game. At 114, I grouped up three games on my list here because they suck equally and they're basically just sequels to one another. It's Jurassic Park, Lost World, and Jurassic Park 3, the board game. Sadly, none of these games are good. None of them. Jurassic Park, the first one, is this huge, immense game. It's got beautiful, all three have beautiful dinosaur pieces. But the first game is just boring. You know, dinosaurs don't eat you. They just block you from going to different areas or move you to a different area. And you're just trying to move around them. It's just a big race from one spot to the next across the island. The second one, they got a little bit more creative, but it's totally scaled in the Raptors' favor. Whoever plays the dinosaurs are going to win every time unless someone makes a bonehead mistake. And then vice versa. In Jurassic Park 3, the humans are going to win every time. Every time. There's just no way you can stop the humans. So just, it's so bad because the games look so good. And I do have a nephew who just loves every time he comes over maybe once or twice a year to spend the night, and he wants to play those dinosaur games. So we'll play them, and I'll let him win a lot of times. I'll be the dinosaur, he'll be the humans, or he'll be the dinosaur, and he wants to win. Boy, that's a long game on Jurassic Park 3. What I do is I kind of cheat myself so the humans will die faster. But just, it's sad. Now, I know they've made a Jurassic Park Danger Island game that looks kind of neat, I'll be honest. But I have a game in my collection called Dinosaur Park or Dinosaur World or whatever. And it's really, Dinosaur Island, that's what it is. And it's really good. And so that, for me, is a Jurassic Park game. These vintage games, though they look nice and bear the title, just don't cut it. At number 113 is Chip and Dale Rescue Rangers. Chip and Dale Rescue Rangers is a game from the Cartoon Afternoon, Disney's Cartoon Afternoon games. I tried to get my wife to play this game with me. She had no interest in playing any of the Disney Afternoon games, so it just didn't get played. Now, I remember it wasn't that good. You're basically just moving around the board trying to find pieces to a little gadget or whatever, and it was really hard to find those pieces and really hard to get to those spots. So, but I did want to give it another shot because it's been a while since I played the game. Unfortunately, it didn't get that shot, so it doesn't make the top 100. At number 112 is the same exact story as Chip 'n Dale Rescue Rangers. It's Darkwing Duck. Now, Darkwing Duck, back in the day, was my favorite cartoon as a kid. And so when I bought the board game, I was really excited about what it would be. I remember it being underwhelming, but then again, I would like to play it again and see if it's still underwhelming because I hadn't played it in so long. But again, couldn't get it to the table, so sadly, it is off the list in the top 100. Number 111 is the Saved by the Bell, technically a trivia game, but you're running around trying to get dates with Zach and, you're meeting up with Kelly and Jesse and Lisa too, but trying to get dates with Zach and Slater too. It's totally for girls. But it's a trivia game. Now, the few times we played this game, my wife has killed me on it because she is a Saved by the Bell expert guru. She knows all the trivia, even today. I didn't know that much. I got a few things right, but not that many. But I think this would be fun with the right crowd. I know Pressman Games re-released this game at Target a few years back, so it's kind of easy to get, if, believe it or not. And it's the same exact game, as far as I know. I have the original version, and it's okay. Like I said, you can get good laughs at it, but you got to get in it with the right group. And there's like one other couple that I know. We haven't had them over to play it. They said they would, and maybe if we had them over to play it, it might make my top 100, but it's just such a small niche, Saved by the Bell. I just don't see this game ever getting moving up that high into my top 100. And we didn't get to play it this year either. So, I mean, like I said, it is a hilarious game when you're playing with adults, especially guys there, you know, trying to get dates with Zach and Slater. But it's fun, but you know, only for a niche group who really, if you have a group that loves Saved by the Bell, yeah, you should get it. But other than that, this is probably never going to make my top 100. Number 110 is the Cabbage Patch Kids Bicycle Race Game. I talked about how awful this is in the past, but I'm going to retract a few of my comments. It's not so bad a game. You could have worse. For some reason, you can play 9 players. I don't know why, but that's insane to me. And there's 9 characters you can just throw around the board, and you're basically just moving the die and racing over cabbage patches that take you randomly to other spots along the board. And, I mean, it's just random craziness, so I guess it's all right. My wife and I played it a couple of times this year. She won both times because she always found the cabbage that took her straight to the end. I mean, she was just that lucky, and she would go, well, I'll just bike somewhere else. I said, why? You're right there at the end, in the game. The first game we played lasted maybe a minute, and the second game was lasting a minute and a half, almost 2 minutes, and she was like, I'll drive away. She drove away from the finish line so she could just, because the games were going too fast, and she knew I wasn't going to play a third time with her. But, in a way, I guess if you like Cabbage Patch Kids, it's all right, but it's just, like I said, it's not as bad a game as I used to think, but it's, I don't think it's ever going to make my top 100. At number 109 is the game Tailspin. Tailspin, I remember right, it's been a year since I played it. Didn't play it this year. Again, tried to get to the table, couldn't get it to the table. But I remember it being fun. It's a very fast game, very easy. You're all controlling the sea duck as it moves around the board, trying to avoid Don Carnage's pirates and getting points. I can't remember a certain way. But like I said, it plays like, I want to say it's like a 5-minute game, maybe 10 minutes tops. And that I enjoyed. But also, I had a little bit of fun because the sea duck piece that moves around is kind of fun. And I wanted to play this one again to see if it can make in my top 100 like it did last year. But because it didn't get to the table, it doesn't make my top 100. At number 108 is probably my favorite of all the Disney Afternoon games. It's the DuckTales game. This game also didn't make my top 100 because it didn't get played this year, which I'm kind of sad about. DuckTales, you are Huey, Dewey, Louie, or Uncle Scrooge. Great 4 players there. You're trying to meet launch pad at the helicopter pad to lift off, but you're being stopped by, I think it's Cruella de Vil. No, not Cruella de Vil. I don't know her name. Magica Dispel. Just thought about it. Magic Dispel, Gloomgold, and one of the Beagle Boys. And it is interesting because you get to move one of those 3 villains to block other players. So you're trying to block other players and send them. There's different paths to go, but you're blocking certain paths and making them go different ways. I really do like that game. I thought it was really smart. It made my top 100 last year, but the reason it drops out, again, couldn't get it to the table. My number 107 is Barbie Dream Date. Shockingly enough, when I gave my review, I told you this game is actually fun. It's very thematic. You're basically Ken trying to, you know, take Barbie on the most wonderful day in the world, and you have so many rounds to prepare. You have 6 rounds to prepare, and at 6 o'clock, I think you pick her up. Then you start taking her to all these places. Prepare, I mean, you're giving her flowers, candy, and something else, a gift or something. And then for the next 6 rounds, you're just trying to take her to as many spots as you can. You're taking pictures. And it's Barbie and Ken dolls at the beach, or going horseback riding, or going out to a dinner date, or to the movies or something. And afterwards, you just go over what your date was like for the evening. Whoever has the best date, meaning the most victory points, wins. It's actually very thematic. It's actually pretty good. I cannot wait to play this with my little girls. I think it's going to soar on my list when it does, because I was shocked how good the game was. Now, my wife was a big proponent for getting this game. I was not. because I thought any Barbie game would suck. But like I said, it is thematic, so I enjoyed it. Unfortunately, we didn't get this game to the table. This is another one I tried to push my wife to get to play, and she didn't want to play it. And of course, my nephews are probably not going to play Barbie Dream Date. I just don't see them doing that. So it'll just have to sit on the shelf there, gather a little dust for the year, and sadly sit out this round in the top 100. At number 106 is the game The Sinking of the Titanic. This is the sinking, it was also renamed later on Abandoned Ship, but it's the same game. Basically, you just one half of the game very quickly. You are trying to save as many passengers as you can for victory points before the ship sinks. If you stay on the ship too long and it sinks, then you're out of the game completely. After that, the next good two-thirds of the game is you trying to get your rescue boat to your little raft, to the rescue ship, which is on the other side of the board. When the Titanic, it's a pretty neat mechanic, when the Titanic flips over, at the very end, there's this little rescue ship that pops up on the other side of the board, and that's where you have to go from one run board to the next. The pieces look great on this, and I have gotten asked a few trades for this year. Just haven't found anything worth trading for it. Everyone wants to get a Titanic game, and there's Titanic fans out there who look for that kind of stuff. And like I said, the pieces look good too. The reason it drops out of my top 100 this year is because a few things. One, I found out that there's some passengers you just can't save. They're on those bottom levels that are going to sink first off. They're the first ones that are going to sink. And there's just no way you can get through to those levels to save them in time. A few times we tried. That's another thing. If you stay too long gathering, saving people on the ship, which that's what you want to do, right? You will die. And when you die, you're out of the game completely. In fact, twice we played this game, the first time, everyone down the ship but one person. So we automatically won by default, right? And the second time, everyone died but me and one other person. He stayed on the ship right to the very end. Well, I got a few riders and I was trying to get there, but the dice, you have to roll these dice and move vertically and then horizontally, or horizontally and vertically on the dice. If the dice don't go your way, you're not hitting islands that you need, or you're hitting the wrong areas and getting the wrong cards, and you're not being able to get to that stupid rescue ship because you're just moving. I get it, you can't control the raft. I mean, kind of thematic, I guess, but you're trying to get to the rescue ship on that raft. And when my nephew hit the water, he just had awesome rolls. A big roll and a small roll. So he used the big roll to go horizontal, small roll to avoid different perils, and he made it straight to the rescue ship before I could. I was like, this is so dumb. It's luck of the roll. And I guess just both of those combined just moved it down from my list for me this year, so that's why it's not on the top 100. At number 105 is the Dukes of Hazzard card game. This is actually a pretty fun card game, and I do enjoy it. I just forgot to bring it to the table one day. I know my wife would love to play anything Dukes of Hazzard, and I just forgot I had it stacked around the back, I think, of my shelf there, which I knew I had some games back there, but I just totally forgot about the Dukes of Hazzard card game. And I definitely would have brought it out, but it didn't get played this year. Usually it's on my top 100, but because it didn't get played, it does miss out. Is there a rule you have to play these games to be on the top 100? No, but there are some decent vintage games in my collection, and so it made it kind of easy for me to decide between two, and I said, well, I didn't even get to play that this year, so I don't know if it still holds up. So that's why Dukes of Hazzard, the card game, didn't make it this year. At number 104 should be no surprise to anyone if you saw my review last year, it's Snardvark. Snardvark is not a game, it is a toy. You're basically, the only choice you have in the game is the color pawn that you pick. That's it. After that, you have to wait to see what his eyes are, what his eyes turn color. That's when you can go move one space, and it's totally just up to him. You're not doing anything. You're not pressing a button. You're just waiting for the electronic device to spin his eyes around and which color pops up. It's like jackpot. And sometimes he gets stuck on red and blue, and those are the only two colors moving for the longest, and green screwed. Or sometimes green and yellow, and then red and blue are screwed or whatever. And it's a toy. It's not a game. This game sells for tons of money. It's definitely not worth it. I bought mine for $20, and I mean, yeah, for a novelty item, maybe. I even told you, my nephews thought was funny, my wife thought was funny, and that's why it was in my top 100 last year. And we played it again because the missus really loved it, and my nephews think it's kind of funny, but they know there's no strategy, but my wife really thought it was fun. So we played a few games of it, but it's not a game. It's a toy, basically, in a board game box being sold as a board game. So I just could not put it on myself to put it in my top 100. However, though, it did get played a few times. So that's why it just barely misses out. At number 103 is a game that's been in my top 100 for years. This is the first time it's actually dropped off my top 100. It is Pie Face. Yes, you're thinking, Matt, why do you still have that on your top 100 for years? Well, because it was a very highly requested game. This was a game that until 2 years ago, I think, was a must on our family vacations. The kids told me I had to bring it every time. And last year, or this past year, they didn't care about it. No one asked, did you bring Pie Face? And then, of course, due to COVID, all of our office parties were canceled. We didn't have any of them. And usually at one of those office parties, like, hey, Matt, bring a game. Bring Pie Face, you know, because Pie Face was a little game we'd play every once in a while. And it was fun, you know. So you just basically spin a wheel and crank that handle so many times. You put whipped cream. You got to put whipped cream on it, and it can smack someone in the face. It's funny, haha. They've come up with several different versions of the game since then, which I have not played. I played one of them, which I thought was kind of dumb. The original one's the one you want to get if you want to get one. Nice little party game. It is a party game, and it did get played, actually. It got played. My nephews and I, they saw it and said, hey, let's play one game of Pie Face. So we played one game of Pie Face. It went off immediately on someone, and then my older nephew looked at me and went, okay, let's play something else. Like, he's like, we've lost the appeal for Pie Face. So I think Pie Face, even though it just barely misses the top 100, I don't think it has a chance of getting back in. My number 102 is the Captain Crunch game. You are Captain Crunch, a Soggy, or the Sog Master, basically just the cereal PVC figures from the cereal boxes back in the day, and you're trying to move around this board by just taking a card, moving that number of spaces, and avoiding pitfalls and stuff, rolls you have to make to beat certain areas. And then, of course, eventually you got to beat off both Soggies and then finally the Sog Master to win, which is really dumb because one of your pawns is the Sog Master, so you have to fight yourself to win the game. I really wish they would have given you just four Captain Crunch PVC characters and then painted their feet. You know, in fact, I still want to do that to this game, but the PVC one PVC Captain Crunch goes for like $5 on eBay. I was like, I'm not paying $15, which is, I think, what I paid for the game, just to get three measly little Captain Crunch PVC cereal figurines. If those things were like $1 or $2 even, I'd probably get them. But shipping's even $1, so then I'm paying $3. I don't know. I don't know what's worth it there. But if I do find more Captain Crunch, you know, little PVC figures, I only need three. I'd paint one blue, one green, and one yellow or something like that, or one red or something. I don't know. And just, you know, have them, have everyone be a Captain Crunch character, and then have those Soggy characters and the Sog Master stand up on the board on the spaces you got to fight them. Now, that would make the game a little bit more thematic there. The game is okay. My wife loves it because she loves Captain Crunch. It's a decent game, but not that good enough, I guess, to be in my top 100. With the right pieces, that's kind of hard to say. With the right pieces, yeah, it may make my top 100 again. Who knows? But for right now, it lands just barely outside. And finally, at 101, what game just barely missed getting in my top 100? It was Where's the Beef? Where's the Beef is like a Wendy's game. It's from their old commercial, their famous commercial, Where's the Beef? In fact, you play the old lady who said that statement as she moves around the restaurant looking under other people's sandwiches, I guess, and trying to find where the beef is. That's kind of weird. And that's what you're doing. You're rolling dice, moving through the restaurant, looking under people's, you know, tokens and trying to see where the beef is. There are four beef tokens. If you're the first one to find them, you scream out, I found the beef! And then you have to flip over. It's a memory game. You have to flip over all four beef tokens. Now, here's the thing. It is a race to get those beef tokens, but you need to have a good memory, too. So many times, this game, it takes forever. The reason why I decided to move it off my top 100, it is a fun game, but I moved it off the top 100 because it does take, it goes a little bit long in the tooth there. When you're just rolling, stop. Roll, stop, move, stop, and you're just looking under plates. You do have to keep your memory up, because a lot of people have said, I found the beef, I put over three of them, and then the fourth one I got wrong. I was like, oh no, and then everyone goes, I found the beef, because they know the one I didn't find. So the game ends very quickly. Either you won, or you will lose, and someone else, the next player, will win. Because at that point, everyone's moved around the restaurant. It's an okay game. Again, if COVID hadn't happened, my goal was to play this inside of a Wendy's. You know, I thought that would have been cool, but we couldn't really play the game inside of a Wendy's. We did get to play the game, but again, like I said, my decisioning factor, why I didn't get my top 100 was because it does go a little bit too long. too long. Maybe if there's three beef patties and less tables, it would have, but would it be a great game? I don't know. Maybe you wouldn't miss, you know, your memory wouldn't be, your memory would be better if there were less tables, that's for sure. So I don't know. Who am I to say? But it is a fun game. All right, folks, those were the games that didn't make my top 100. What games did? Find out next time. See you later.